This is the part we'll spend most of the time on. That's the MIP2. I'm going to discuss the old MIP2, but partly also the new modules that are based on this MIP2. Probably interesting to understand why there's the number 2 here. Well, the number 2 is there because we also had a MIP1. But that one is outdated, it's historic. It's defined here in RFC 1156. The MIP2 looks at management of the variables that relate to the TCP/IP protocol stack. So it does not look at the things below IP, so it doesn't look at Ethernet, and it doesn't look higher to all kinds of applications. If you count the number of variables, then you get about 170 variables, most of them being read-only. So you can read a lot of stuff, but you cannot change a lot of things. Well, this is the RFC, which defines MIP2, and as said, MIP2 is defined according to SMR version 1. The MIP2 consists of a number of groups, and these groups are now being taken apart, defined in separate MIP modules, and I've just written down here the RFCs and the groups that are currently valid, but they do not have yet full standards status. Let's first look at the design criteria behind the MIP2, because that makes it clearer why certain things are not there. First, only things that were essential for fault or configuration management were included in the MIP2. The term essential means that there are no options, so you have to implement everything. Except, of course, when you have a bridge that doesn't have TCP protocol, you do not have to implement the variables to manage the TCP protocol, because you do not have it. But if you support a protocol, then you should also implement all the management variables, so that no options, that's why the term essential is used. And the second thing is that we again see here that this is for fault and to a lesser extent configuration management. It's not for security management or for accounting. Sometimes you can do a little, but then you just have luck. It was not designed to be useful for accounting. The second design criteria is that only weak control objects should be included. What are control objects? Well, control objects are objects that control the behavior of the system. So if you change the control object, the system will behave differently. So control objects always are settable. If they're just readable, they do not control anything. So there are not many objects that you can set. And if you can set them, they do not have a lot of impact on the system in general. Take, for example, the IP address of a system. There is a variable that indicates the IP address of a system, but you cannot change as a manager via SNMP that variable. It's only read-only. Why? Well, if you could change that, you could, of course, change the complete behavior of the system by just giving it another address. And security is relatively weak with SNMP version 1. So if you would allow these things to be set, you run into big security problems. A third thing is that there are only a relatively small number of objects defined. I already said that there are around 170 divided over 9 groups. Then, redundant variables should not be there. So there should no variables be defined that can be calculated from other variables. Take for example, if you have the variable the number of packets received without the CRC error, and another variable, the number of packets received with CRC error, then you do not need a third variable to indicate the total number of packets that you receive, because you can calculate it by taking the first and second one together. So, no things that you can calculate from other variables. Evidence of utility, so that means that while standardizing, people didn't agree on something. Well, it wasn't evidence, so it was thrown out. Another aspect that is important is do not disturb normal operation. So, do not, well, why is this important? Quite simple. If you have to update variables, it can take you quite some processor time of your router of whatever device you're managing. And it is expensive. You also need extra memory for your management functionality. And if you just count everything that could presumably be interesting, you probably spend 90% of your time on updating management variables and only 10% of your time on doing the real stuff. Like, for instance, if you're a router, you only spend 10% of your capacity on forwarding traffic. Well, that's of course wrong, but it is a risk which is really existing. A lot of people make that mistake. So, what kind of things should be included? Not the normal operation. You shouldn't count too much on the things that go right. You should count the things that go wrong. So concentrate on the weird behavior. Further, the MIP2 doesn't have any implementation-specific stuff, so it is a kind of functional MIP, and it's not a physical MIP. It doesn't count, for instance, the number of bytes free within the router, or the number of processors running on your system. For that you need, for instance, the host resources MIP. This is the naming structure of the MIP2. We'll see here a couple of groups. We have the system group, interfaces group, address translation group, the IP group, the ICMP group, TCP group, UDP group, EGP group, transmission group, and SNMP group. First interesting thing is that if you count here, we'll go up till 8 and we'll miss 9. 9 was originally in the MIP1. The branch reserved for CMOT, Common Management over TCP, so OSI management protocols in the internet world. But as I told last time, CMOT is historic, so in the MIP2 they removed that branch. Further, the transmission group is in fact just a placeholder. It doesn't have in the MIP2 any variables, but it allows you to put transmission MIPs under. An SNMP was added in the MIP2, which wasn't in the MIP1. This is the protocol view of a system, and the colored stuff are the groups that are defined in the MIP2. The address translation is in fact the ARP, address resolution protocol stuff. It does the mapping between the IP addresses and the MAC addresses or other lower layer addresses. And the interfaces should be seen as abstractions of the transmission protocols below. So they count generic things like number of things that come in, and number of things that go out, and number of errors, but they do not count the number of collisions, because that's something specific for Ethernet. What I will do now is I'll go over these various groups. Let's start with the system group. The system group is defined in the original MIP2, has 7 variables, and these variables are sysdescription, which is a string filled in by the vendor describing what kind of system this is. Come to an example later. You have sysobjectid, which is an object identifier that points to enterprise specific MIP. So a MIP that is defined by the vendor of this system. You have sys uptime. That's the time the system is, well, the management portion of the system was last reinitialized or just started up. And it's measured in 100s of seconds. Then I'll come to three things which are written down in red and bold. The meaning of that is that red variables are ones that you can write. All the others you can only read. So there are some things we can write here. SysContact, which indicates whom to contact if you have any questions. Usually an email is included in that. SysName, so the name of the system. SysLocation, the place where the system is actually standing. Finally, there's SysServices, and I'll explain that a little on the next slide. SysServices is in fact one byte with the bits that can take specific values. If the last bit is set, it says that the system includes physical layer capabilities. If the second bit is set, it has data link capabilities. If the third one is set, it has internet, so IP level capabilities. If this one is set, it has end-to-end capabilities. And if this bit is set, it has application capabilities. If you have an manager system, you like to have such a graphical user interface with nice icons on it. And usually you want to have different icons for different pieces of equipment. And by reading this byte, you know what kind of equipment is there. So you know what kind of icon you have to show on your screen. And that's what people do with it. It's quite helpful. I'll try to give an example of this.
Okay, let's go on.
I'll go through the other groups. I'll show you examples of these other groups. Let's look at the interfaces group. The interfaces group is structured quite simple. It has a table and it has an interface number variable. The interface number variable indicates the number of entries in this table. So, number of interfaces you have. Huh? If you have on your system just an Ethernet card, you have one interface. How does that interface table look like? But first, let's go through the conventions on my sheets. This is again red, so this means that this is a variable you can set. I'll come to that later. And blue are the things that are the index values of the table. So the table is indexed via this field, and that's the IF index. It is just something that is number, a unique number. Doesn't even have to be a continuous numbering scheme. Okay, what do we have? We have an interface description, which is the vendor name and the version number of this interface. You have an interface type. I'll show it here. This is the interface type. You have there lots of numbers, and I just wrote down some of them. And, if the number is 1, it says that the interface is of an unknown or undefined type. If it is number 6, it is an Ethernet. If it is number 7, it's the IEEE 802.3 version, which is nearly the same as Ethernet, but there's some small differences. If it is number 8, it is a token bus, something that hardly anyone is using anymore. If it is 9, it is token ring. If it's 10, it is the metropolitan area network stuff of the IEEE DQDB. 15 is FDDI, the fiber distributed data interface. This is LAB-B, something related to the X25 protocol. This is ISDN basic access, ISDN primary rate, point-to-point protocol, loopback, serial line IP, frame relay, and this goes on. I just counted yesterday. There are now 167 different types of interfaces. And this list is growing the entire time. And this list is maintained by the IANA. IANA is the group that is also maintaining lots of things for the internet. Internet Assigned Number Authority, IANA. IFMTU, that's the maximum. The IF speed. The physical address, which is usually the MAC address, if you are on a local area network. Then we have the administrative status and the operational status. And here, the IF last change shows the last change here of this operational status. Now we get a lot of variables, which I skip, except a few of them. I'll skip them because I have a better slide later. I'll just concentrate on some. The IF in octets, that's the number of octets, so number of bytes that are coming in this system over this interface. And we have here the IF out octets, that's the number that is going out. I also want to look at this one, the queue length, so how many packets are queued before transmission. And you have here a field which is a pointer to a specific MIP. So if, for instance, the type here indicates that this is an Ethernet interface, then you can find here the pointer to the Ethernet MIP. If you want to know the number of collisions, for instance, you should follow this pointer and you'll find the Ethernet-specific stuff. I said I'll skip most of these for now, and I'll explain them on the next slide, and that's what I'm going to do now. Here I have written down all these variables again, but now in something that we usually call a case diagram. And the case diagram shows us a little bit the relationship between the various counters. This indicates a stream of packets coming in, and this indicates the stream of packets coming out. Well, let's start with things that are coming in. If things come in, we first count the number of errors. So errors are things like CRC errors. So some bits has changed and you have to throw away the packet because of that. If you throw away the packet, then you increase IF in errors. This is the unknown protocols. Usually you run IP, but it could be that you want to run something different, which is not supported on your system. Then you increase this counter and you throw away the packet. Again, there may be a reason to throw away the packet. You discard the packet, and that is because of internal problems. For instance, you do not have enough buffer space left. Your system is overloaded. You have to throw away things. Then you increase this one. These are the possibilities to throw packets away. If you don't throw them away, you give them to the IP layer. And there are two kinds of packets. You have unicast packets, which have one specific destination, and you have non-unicast, so multicast and broadcast package. And you count them separately, and they together form the total number of packets. So you do not have, for instance here, one variable showing you the total number of packets. On the other hand, if you send something out, you'll count the number of unicast packets that you send out, you count the number of non-unicast packets, you count the number of packets which you have to throw away because of an error. An error can be that the cable is disconnected. If I just put the plug out, then I cannot send something, and then this counter will be increased. And there may again be reasons which have to do with internal implementation, that I do not have enough buffer space or whatever. I can still throw the packet away in that case, and I have to increase that counter. So that is the all these variables in the interface group. Let's go again to this group. You'll see here lots of packets, but usually most operators just look at some of these packets, because most of these packets give you already too detailed information. But just looking at some, you get already quite some useful information. And I'll show you an example. These kind of pictures, you'll you see very often with operators. And how do they generate it? By just looking at some of the variables in the interface table. In fact, very simple, but still very useful. Okay, now I'll go to the next table, the address translation group. In fact, it has just one single table. And you can look at this table as a kind of ARP address resolution protocol, an ARP cache. And the number of entries here are the same as the number of interfaces you have. The status of this table is deprecated. There are some new tables that have similar information. I'll come to that later, the IP Net2 Media table and the IP address table. How does the table look like? Well, quite simple. You here have the index, and this is the other index, the net address. So this is the IP address, and then you find here the physical address. Let's go to the IP layer. The IP layer, we have lots of variables, and we have some tables. And there are only two variables which are in red, so there are two variables that you can set. The first one is IP forwarding, which indicates if the system is forwarding traffic or not. If it's forwarding traffic, then it is in fact a router. If it's not forwarding traffic, then it's an end system. And this is the IP default time to live. So that is the time to live field that is filled in the packets that are generated by this system. Usually you have something like 30. Then we have a lot of variables which I can better explain via a case diagram. That's this diagram. It's quite similar to the IF diagram I showed earlier, except that if something comes in now, it need not always be delivered to the higher layer. If the system is routing, or is forwarding traffic, then it goes here and out again. So that explains this arrow. Well, what kind of variables do we have? First, we count the number of IP packets that we receive. Then we look if there are any errors in the header, a small checksum in the header. There's some fields that may not take certain values, and if you detect these kind of errors, you throw away the packet and you increase this counter. You can also have an address error. An address error is if you have an end system, and you have address A, B, C, D, but you receive something for X, Y, Z, Z. And, well, X, Y, Z, Z is not your address. It was delivered to you, but it didn't belong here, so you throw away the packet and you increase this counter. Well, then you make the decision if the packet should be forwarded to another system or not. If it is not being forwarded, but it should go to the higher layer in this system, you can first look at the fragmentation flag in the IP packet. If the fragmentation flag says that this package should be reassembled, so it was segmented, fragmented somewhere else, and this is the end system, you have to combine it. Then you count the number of these fragments that you receive. If reassembly fails because there's one fragment missing, you throw away everything and you increase this counter. If it is okay, then you increase this counter. Here you have the complete IP packet again, and you can discard it because you do not have sufficient buffer space. You can throw it away because the higher level protocol isn't known to you. If you see in the system that this one has a high value, then you know that the routing table is not configured correctly. You can discard it because of buffer space or whatever. You may have to segment the or fragment the packet, which again has three variables which you can increase, and then finally you send it away. And of course, if you forward things, then you have here a counter IP forwarded datagrams. I have explained in the IP group these variables, and now I'm going to look at these tables. The first table I want to look at is the IP address table. And that's this one. And the address table maps the IP address to an interface. In fact, an interface index. So this is the index that we have seen in the interface table. It doesn't directly map the IP address on the MAC address. So there you need an additional step from the interface index to the MAC address. What does it also show? It shows you the net mask, which you use for classless interdomain routing. You see you have the IP address, entity broadcast address, something like that, and the reassembly maximum size. Let's go to the next table. On the previous table, we saw how we could map from an IP address to an interface, and here we can map from an interface to a MAC address. Here we have the interfaces again. Here we have the MAC addresses again. Here we have the IP addresses. This one and this one together form the index, so if you know your IP address, you can easily find the MAC address. And you also have here a type which says if this address is configured by the manager, or if it is something static, or it has been obtained via a dynamic algorithm, a kind of protocol. So not by a human being, but it may change. So let's now go to the routing table. The routing table is the third table I want to discuss, and this one is a little bit interesting since you see that there are lots of things in red. So you can set lots of things. This is quite strange. If you look at the other things in the MIP, you cannot set a lot of things, but the routing table, you can. What you see here is the destination where you can send something to. The IP address of the next system along the path. The interface you should use to get there. The mask that you need. Then you have a route type. And then you have here a couple of route metrics. Route H. The protocol that you're using. And for that protocol you can have a pointer to a specific other MIP. What is wrong with this table? If you just look here, you see that there's only one index, so you cannot have multiple routes to, for instance, this system, because then you would have to repeat this IP address here, and you get two entries with the same index, and that's not possible. That's why this table is now deprecated, and they have a forward table, which has multiple indexes. I'll now go to the forwarding table. The forwarding table is something added later because the routing table had the problem that you could only have one metric for a specific destination. The forwarding table solves that. And if you look at the table, then you see that there are many blue columns, so you can index this on a couple of things. The destination, then the next hop, the policy, and the protocol that you're using. So there's enough to make things unique. Now I'll go to the ICMP group. ICMP group is in fact a long list of counters. And ICMP is the Internet Control Message Protocol. I've shown that in this list. In fact, you have one counter which counts the total number that's coming in. Then you have a counter for the number of errors. Then for the various ICMP message types, there's a different counter. And also if you send something, then for the various things you generate, you have for each type of ICMP message a separate counter. Number of errors, which the things you throw away, and number of outgoing messages. Next one is the TCP group. TCP group has again a couple of variables and one table, the connection table. If you look at the variables, we have here first a variable indicating which kind of retransmission algorithm we're using. The maximum number of connections that you allow at TCP level, the counter for all the active opens since the system has restarted, counter for all the passive opens since the system has restarted, the counter for the connection attempts that failed, the number of the count for the number of resets, the counter for the current number of TCP connections, the number of ingoing and outgoing segments, the number of retransmitted segments. This is the connection table. This is the errors, and this is the number of resets or something like that. I'll now just go to the connection table. The connection table says the connection state. This one can be set by the manager. And you here have the states like closed, listen, that you send an sync, at a couple of these things that you have in the protocol. And with this, you can abort as manager a TCP connection. This is indexed by the local TCP address, the local TCP port, the remote TCP address, and the remote TCP port. Next one is UDP. UDP is four counters. The number of UDP packets that you deliver to the higher layer. The number of packets you cannot deliver to the higher layer because you do not know the port. So the higher layer protocol and the errors. And also you have a counter for the things that you send out. EGP is Exterior Gateway Protocol. I don't know why they ever included that in the MIP2, because you have also a lot of other routing protocols. This is the structure, I'm not going to that. Transmission group, which was the placeholder for transmission MIPS, doesn't have any real variables. These are just other MIP modules. Finally, we have the SNMP group, which consists of a large number of read-only counters. It counts the number of transmitted SNMP PDUs, the number of received SNMP PDUs. You have different types of SNMP PDUs, so you even count it for that, and you count the number of errors. And there is one thing that the manager can change, and that is something that enables or disables the sending of authentication traps. So